Why is the modern evangelical church around the world in such a dire state of virtual, total apostasy? And why aren't Christian church leaders standing up for biblical truth? Why is it that so many ordinary people like myself, I've never been a church leader, in fact, I've never even been a church member, although I made a profession of faith in 1985 in London. Why is it that so many church members just seem to ignore the apostasy in the church and won't stand for truth? What's the connecting theme? What's the overriding problem and the cause of this deep apostasy? Well, I don't wish to use foul language, but you can sum it up with a rather uncouth phrase. And it's this: most people in the church are half-assed. They really are. The pastors are half-assed. They just want the tithe, the free house, the free car, the pension, the salary. They're half-assed. They couldn't care less if Christ is blasphemed in their church or in the church down the road. They just want an easy, comfortable life with people sitting in the pews who don't ask difficult questions, which makes their life easy. The pastors are half-assed. Many people sitting in the pews, and by the way, the clergy-laity division is completely unbiblical. You didn't have church buildings in the first century with a raised platform with a clergy at one side and then facing them in chairs. You had the laity facing them. This was a later invention. And Christ himself in Revelation chapter 2, I think it's verse 6 to 8, he says he hates the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. Nicolaitans comes from two Greek words, Nikos, or from which we get the word Nike, as in the shoe, to conquer, and Laos, the people. It's a clergy class who've conquered the people. God says he hates that. But why do so many people in the pews accept this situation? And why is their problem that they're half-assed also? And the reason is that if you read the Bible, even a smattering of biblical understanding will tell you that the God of the Bible, and again, I don't wish to use foul language, but the word half-assed is appropriate. God doesn't like people like that. And many people in the pews are half-assed, just like the clergy are half-assed. And deep down, they know that God is not going to accept them. And so that's why the people in the pews want to have a clergy-laity division, because they want to pay money for a pastor who's going to be their mediator between them and God. Now, of course, 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5 says there's one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Christ is the one we go to. He is our mediator between God the Father and us. But of course, if you're your average evangelical church member, you're half-assed. You know God's not going to accept you. God's not even going to listen to you because you're not serious about your faith. It's all a front. You're half-assed. And so that's why these people want to have a pastor. They want to have a one-man band ruling over them. Even though it's not biblical, even though in the Bible, look at Acts 14:23, Acts 15:2, Acts 20:17, we read there about churches being run by a plurality of elders. Churches used to meet in people's houses. They didn't have special church buildings. If you had a group of people meeting in a house, the fellowship couldn't be very large, and yet it was run by a plurality of unpaid elders. They had to be unpaid, because if you only had a fellowship of 30 or 40 people, more than half of whom were children or women, how could you afford to pay the salaries, the pensions, the houses, and the free chariot and the free horse, and the education for the kids of three or four elders? Everybody worked unpaid in the church. But the clergy-laity division has made the clergy into hirelings who are just after the money. And whereas true Christians should be upset and angered at the hypocrisy and the blasphemy they see in the church, the hirelings aren't. As long as it's not happening in their church, they're happy. And of course, when it does happen in their church, then they use church elders or other such church leaders to cover it all up. There's no real repentance in most cases, as I have found out to my cost. 2 years ago, I exposed a series of disgusting sexual affairs by church leaders, including a church pastor and his church evangelist with the same woman. And for exposing another sex scandal, including two church leaders, I actually went to prison for 28 days on a charge of harassment. I can't mention the names. I'd like to. But I stood for biblical truth, and the churches en masse complained to the police that I was harassing them by asking them to obey the Bible, which teaches that fornication by church leaders is a sin. And the unrepentant church leaders who had this affair, they put me in prison. Well, the clergy-laity division just makes the average Joe in the pew more lazy and more half-arsed. What's the solution? Well, I've made many mistakes in my life, but there's one thing I got absolutely right. I left a cult in 1989. I was only in it for 7, 8, 9 months. It was called Oneness, or the Apostolic Movement, or Jesus Only. It's taken over about a quarter of Pentecostalism across the world, in that it's a form of anti-Trinitarian Pentecostalism. Pentecostals who deny the Trinity, who believe in the oneness doctrine, that Jesus is the Father, and Jesus is the Son, and Jesus is the Holy Spirit. By the way, I live in Plymouth in the UK, and I can take you to church after church after church here, where church leaders will have a Trinitarian doctrinal statement up on their website. Even Baptist churches, members of the Baptist Union of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. And yet, I have been told to my face repeatedly, again and again and again, by church leaders, that Jesus is the Father. In other words, churches that have a Trinitarian statement of faith, that part of a Trinitarian denomination, they're teaching modalism. And try as I have done for many years to speak out about this, I'm wasting my time, because no one is going to listen. Well, I came out of Oneness in 1989. I tried going to different churches, from Pentecostal churches to Reformed churches. And I came to the conclusion that all of them just wanted me to sit in a pew and rot. Because, you see, in Christianity, once you know the Christ of the Bible, you're supposed to be trained like a soldier for battle. You're not supposed to sit in a pew and have lectures given to you by some university type, well, not a university type preacher. Most of the sermons you hear today are hopeless. A fourth-rate wannabe university lecturer. See, that's what happens. People are just talked to. They listen to one of the clergy class speak to them in monologue. Blah, 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 Jesus, Jesus, blah, 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 Jesus. And then you go home and I didn't, but many people live like the devil, you know. You do what you want during the week, including many sexual affairs if you want it. It's all covered up in these churches. And you come back next week and the preacher boy, blah, 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 Jesus in his sermon, blah, 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 Jesus, Jesus, blah, blah, blah. And they just talk to you. They talk to you in monologue. But there's no dialogue. Jesus, if you study Jesus in the Bible, he talked to people in dialogue. Dialogue is a two-way conversation. A monologue is where one person just talks to you and you're supposed to sit there and listen. And so what I did was I decided that I simply wasn't going to learn anything, no matter which church I went to. And I tried them all. I tried them all, from Baptist, Pentecostal, Charismatic, even one or two liberal Anglican churches, right through to Reformed. And all of them just want you to sit in the pew. What I decided to do was to evangelize the cults, Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, Christadelphians, which I have done since 1989, so I've been doing that for getting on for 30 years now. Because if you do that, what happens is you're training for the battle. You become a soldier in the army of Christ, standing for biblical truth. That's what the pastors are supposed to be doing, and that's what many of them are not doing. Because I can assure you, I have told pastor after pastor after pastor here in Plymouth about the scandals in these various churches here in Plymouth. The sexual scandals in the churches, involving not every form of leader, from the pastor, through the elders, through the evangelist, through the people in the pew. People jumping into bed with each other and then saying, don't judge me or I'll report you to the police for harassment. Under the British Prevention from Harassment Act 1997, all you need to do is to cause distress. And that's what I did when I exposed a sexual scandal involving church leaders, two church leaders. I caused them distress, even though it's truthful, and even though what I did was in a total accordance with the Bible and with the teaching of both of these two churches. I went to prison for 28 days. What you have today in the modern churches, the modern evangelical churches, is an army of paper tigers, biblically illiterate people who are half-assed, who don't really care, who don't know the God of the Bible. Deep down, they know God's not going to accept them, so that's why they love the pastor. The pastor can be, they can push him to the front, they pay him money, they pay him a salary, he's got a free house, he's got a free car, they push him to the front of the queue, and they can hide behind him. He can be their mediator between God and them, or at least that's what they think. But what you have is an army of people who listen to sermon after sermon after sermon, preached to them in monologue. There's no discussion of these sermons, there's no discussion of Christian doctrine. In many evangelical churches, different points of view are not permitted. A funny story was, I remember speaking to a person about the doctrine of the Trinity in a Trinitarian Elim Pentecostal church. This was many years ago. And they had a view, incorrect, that Jesus was God the Father, which is modalism. And I simply went through the ancient creeds. The Trinitarian ancient creeds, talking about Jesus Christ being fully God and fully man, eternally begotten of the Father, of one substance with the Father. He's begotten, not made. The word begotten there refers to eternally begotten, monogenes. And they started pointing the finger and binding demons in me, binding the demons in me, because I was using big words and big concepts that they didn't understand. Even though they were attending a church which claimed to be Trinitarian, which had a Trinitarian statement on its website. And I was simply reiterating that Trinitarian doctrinal statement, saying, yes, I believe that. These people are so biblically illiterate that when you actually preach their own doctrine to them, they think that you are possessed by demons. What we're seeing in our own day is that evangelical Christianity is just a paper tiger. And it's going to fall over the next few years. Whether it takes 10 years, 20 years, or 50 years, it is not going to stand up to Islam, and it's not going to stand up to secular humanism. Because unfortunately, so many evangelical Christians are biblically illiterate fools. They don't know the Bible. They're biblically illiterate. They have not been trained for battle. I evangelized the JWs, as I said, from 1979. JWs, Mormons, Christadelphians, Oneness Pentecostals, the lot. And every time I spoke to these members of cults, I tried to learn. I would write down scribble notes in a wide margin Bible and then on cards, now on computer files. I would try to learn from each witnessing encounter that I had. I would develop and grow, but I was training myself like a soldier for battle. If you want to fight in a battle as a soldier, it's no good sitting in a lecture theater and just listening to Pastor Boy preach sermons to you on a Sunday. You're not going to be a very effective soldier if that's all you do. If you're going to be a boxer in the ring, or if you're going to fight in mixed martial arts, you know, like that Conor McGregor fighter in the big cage that I think I saw it once or twice on TV. If you're going to actually fight in that, you have to train. You have to train seriously, because you're going to be in the boxing ring or in the mixed martial art cage with a guy opposite you who's going to be trying to beat the living daylights out of you. Or if you're a soldier in the army, you better learn to fire your gun. You better learn the techniques of warfare, because if you don't, you're going to be cannon fodder. And unfortunately, this is the situation in so many churches. People aren't learning the Bible, they're not being trained for battle, they are mere paper tigers who, when they come across an informed, educated Muslim or an informed, educated atheist, they have no answer to give. They cannot defend the Bible. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15 says, "Give to everyone who asks of you an answer for the faith that you have within you." And these people often don't have any faith. Their faith is often just their own emotions, or a product of their own emotions. They don't really know the God of the Bible. They can't really explain that Christ is fully God and fully man. They certainly can't explain Christ's physical, literal, bodily resurrection from the dead. Even though 1 Corinthians 15 tells us that this resurrection is the basis of the gospel. We should know this. We should know the gospel. We should know who Christ is. We should know and understand the new covenant. That Hebrews 9:14-15 says that the new covenant is a covenant made between God the Father and the Son of God, Jesus Christ, mediated through the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit applies this new covenant to us. That's the basis of our salvation. If Jesus Christ made a covenant with God the Father on the cross, and that is the basis of our salvation, then our good works can't add to that. And yet here in Plymouth, church after church after church will tell you, you've got to pay your tithe. Malachi chapter 3 verse 10 says, pay your tithes, bring ye all the food into the storehouse, which they misinterpret as the local evangelical church. And then if you read further on in Malachi 3, it talks about people being cursed with a curse. And that, of course, is the non-tithers. How can that be when we have every blessing in Christ Jesus through this new covenant? How can people be back under the Old Testament Levitical law of tithing, which, by the way, was food, it wasn't money, and they paid three tithes, not one tithe, and the tithe was paid to the Levitical priests. Nehemiah 10:37, you paid your tithes to the Levitical priests and your offerings, sorry, you paid your tithes to the Levites, I beg your pardon, that's a mistake. You paid your tithes to the Levites, Nehemiah 10:37, and you paid your offerings to the Levitical priests. Evangelicalism, they've really just abandoned the Bible. They're like the Jehovah's Witnesses. They take a verse completely out of context and they just apply it any way that they like. And then they say, don't judge me. Don't question me. Don't judge me. And they just walk away from you. And in my case, not just with Jehovah's Witnesses on the street when I politely try to speak to them on their trolleys, but also in these evangelical churches, they call the police on you. That's happened to me many times. You disagree with their theology, they call the police. I'm being harassed. Somebody's harassing me here. You can't question these people. It's a law unto themselves. And that's really the problem. The problem is that from the pastor through the elders to Billy Bob Joe, Sister Simple and Brother Gullible sitting in the pew, all of them are half-assed. The preachers are often hirelings who just want the money. They want to have a compulsory tithing so the preacher boy can get his free house and his free car, his salary and his pension. And Sister Simple and Brother Gullible, deep down they know God's not going to accept them because they're both half-assed. So they want to have a pastor as their mediator. Of course, this happened for many years in Catholicism. You had seven sacraments, the Mass, Baptism, Confirmation. And these sacraments, I think it's the bishop who does confirmation, but the other sacraments would be given by the priest, the Roman Catholic priest. The Catholic priest was seen as the mediator between you and God. Well, it's blasphemy. 1 Timothy 2:5, there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. You go directly to Christ. He is your mediator. You don't go to some priest or some Billy Bob Joe pastor. And that's the problem. People are half-assed. And the solution is train for battle. Make it hard. And what you will find is many of the people who are not properly converted will just fall away. Stop trying to teach people like you teach children in a school. If you teach a child in a school, the children will often say, is this going to be in our exam, what we're learning today? If you say, no, it's not, they get out the mobile phones. They start mucking around. Why should they study and learn? You've just told them this isn't in the exam. So teachers will often say, oh yes, this could well be in the exam, and even if they know it's not. So the class will pay attention and learn. Well, it's exactly like that in Christianity. If you stand up in your pulpit and it's blah, 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 Jesus, Jesus, blah, 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 and you're not really telling them anything, and the people in the pews know that they're never going to be soldiers in a battle for Christ. They're never going to be fighting Christ's enemies. They're just paper tigers who sit in a pew and do their silly religion, which is a privatized thing inside a special building called a church building. Jesus didn't build buildings, did he? He went out from town to town speaking to people in the public places. But today's Christianity, well, it's actually been through, it was exacerbated by Constantine in the 4th century. They built buildings. And now Christianity became something that was a sort of privatized thing that you did inside a special building. Well, you have to start training people for battle. You have to start training for battle, because if you know you're going to be actually risking your life in some war as a soldier, then that's going to make your training, going to make you pretty determined for your training. And likewise, if you sit in a church pew and you know you're never going to be in the battle for Christ, you're just going to be there protected by your pastor boy who you pay his pension and his salary. He's got a free house, he's got a car, and then pastor boy's son is going to become the next pastor boy pastor, because there's lots of nepotism in these churches. Well, you know, you're never going to be a man of God. You're never going to be in the battle for Christ. You're never going to be countering Islam, countering atheists, defending the gospel by speaking up against Mormons or Jehovah's Witnesses. You're never going to do that. You're just going to be sitting in the pew and letting your pastor boy do that. Well, what's that going to do to you? It's going to make you lazy. It's going to make you idle. Because you're just like the kid in the school. If the teacher says, oh, this isn't going to be in the exam, the class I'm teaching right now, the kids muck around. They don't need to learn. They don't need to study. And so likewise, everything you do in church that isn't training for battle, it's a waste of time. It really is. People aren't going to learn. Just listening to some idiot stand up and talk in monologue to them, blah, 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 Jesus, blah, 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 this, you're not going to learn anything. Why? There's no exam, there's no battle at the end of it. You want to stop being half-assed for God? Then start training for the battle and get into the battle. Stand for biblical truth. If you believe, as I do, that Christ is fully God and fully man, and that God is triune, he's a trinity, he has eternal, which means that God has eternally, personally, and distinctly existed as God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And he's existed as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit from all eternity, personally, and he has existed distinctly as the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. So God the Father is not Jesus Christ. God the Father is not the Holy Spirit. The Son is not the Holy Spirit. The Son is not the Father. They are distinct, which means you can tell them apart. The Son being eternally begotten from the Father, the Holy Spirit being eternally proceeding from the Father. You need to know these things. You need to train for battle, because if you train for battle, and you get into the battle, you won't be half-assed, like 95% of what calls itself born-again evangelical Christianity today, most of which I believe is fake counterfeit Christianity anyway. Thank you.